Howdy, howdy, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Nick and Knarf, the program that answers the question, what question? Okay, and we're glad you're here today to join us. We got a real special show for you today. We are going to do one of my favorite bands of all time. Nick likes them, not as big a fan as me, but they are awesome. It's thepolice. A great, great group formed in 1977 in England with the three great stars and tremendous musicians. Obviously, the inimitable Sting, who was the lead singer and bassist, Stewart Copeland, who played the drums, and Andy Summers on guitar and bass and stuff. Just three guys putting out some amazing, amazing sounds. Only made five albums, but they sold over how many?
75 million with five albums.
Can you believe that? Five albums in a period of perhaps like 9 years, eight, 9 years. The albums are, the first one was Outlandos de Amor, which came out in 1978. Then the big album, which really shot their career forward, which is Regatta de Blanc, has Walking on the Moon and Message in a Bottle. That was the one that got them a lot of attention. And then the next album, Zenyatta Madonna in 1980, Ghostinthemachine from 1981, and the final album, perhaps the most monster of them all, Synchronicity, which was an enormous, enormous success and followed up with a huge global tour that I've got a video copy of their tour of Synchronicity. It's just tremendous, showcasing all the amazing talent of Sting and Andy Summers and Stewart Copeland. They're just so, so great.
In the 2000s, they did a reunion tour, I was reading, and they were the number one earning act in the world at that time. So a group that only made five albums decides to reunite. I think it was in the year 2003, they were actually added to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
That's right.
But they made a reunion tour, and in that year, they were the number one earners of musicians worldwide.
That amazing. And then, of course, after Police broke up, Sting has his illustrious solo career that's gone on since the mid-80s. Just been a tremendous force in popular rock and other forms of music. The Police, if you haven't heard them, which I wouldn't understand why you haven't, started out really as a new wave band with the British new wave that started to reemerge in the very late 70s, early 80s. And they were based on ska, a little bit of punk, reggae, right, and rock and roll. And then their music evolved in the later albums into the distinctive, unique sound. Not to say that the first sounds weren't unique and interesting, but they really got more sophisticated lyrically, musically, thematically, and it was all driven a lot by the great talented singing and songwriting of Sting. And I got to tell you this little stupid story. I was watching Saturday Night Live one night, and what's his name? Steve Martin was the host, and he made this joke because Sting was going to be the performer that night, the musical act. And he goes, okay, now let's welcome our next guest. And he goes, Stingy. Oh, wait, that's a typo. It's Sting. But I always remember that, because if you do put a Y at the end of Sting, you get Stingy. But anyway, a great, great act. Anyhow, if you like what you're hearing today, we invite you, please subscribe, like, and share. Be a part of the tribe. Join us on our journey. If you subscribe, we really appreciate all your support.
Couple little ditties that I want to add. Number one is, remember, one of their biggest songs was Roxanne. My wife's name is Roxanne. When that song came out, it was like, for me, it was like listening to fingernails on a chalkboard. Okay. I just didn't like that song, Roxanne. Of course, everybody would go around as soon as I'd introduce Roxanne. They got Roxanne, you know, so it drove me nuts. And that's one of the reasons I had this bias. Now, the other thing is, I have this deep respect for Sting being a bass player and being able to sing the way he does, because he doesn't just do bump, 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 bump. You know, I mean, he's playing a lot of notes. So Paul McCartney, you got Cetera of Chicago, and Sting, probably the three most
famous bass players who sing.
Yeah, famous bass players sing. I'm sure there's others. Do you know any
others? I forgot. There might be a couple others. I'm sure.
But that's one class that I think is very unique, kind of like when you mentioned drummers who are lead singers. But, I mean, this guy throws in a lot of great riffs in his music. Yeah. So I got to give him credit for that. It was just that his voice in the beginning used to really irritate the crap out of me. So that's one of the reasons why I didn't listen to their lot of stuff. And then Frank, literally, I found out today that they only did 5 albums. I had no idea.
Oh, yeah. But okay. 5 outstanding, memorable, unforgettable albums. And we're going to play 2. Nick has selected a song, hard to believe, as little as he knows about him. He knows enough to pick some of their best stuff. And one he's selected is off of the 1981 album, Ghost in the Machine. And it is Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic. Just song. A great song. So
it is a great
without
song.
Further ado, let's get into it. Here's The Police with Every Little Thing.
Only 3 guys.
3 guys playing here. Here we go. Every Little Thing. Subtle outro here.
You know, you got to admit, Sting is one of those guys that as soon as you start hearing him sing, you go, that's Sting. I mean, you just know who it is.
What a distinctive voice. Just an amazing
voice. I found it interesting, too, that they decided to make the drums, I think, the most out front instrument in this whole song. Did you notice that?
I know. I mean, it's just amazing how they
even
do
more
it.
Than the vocal. I thought the drum was more out front.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah.
I mean, why is that?
Stewart Copeland's drumming is just...
That was really good.
He's such an uniquely styled drummer, the way he does it. They're just so great. And you hear some of those bass lines that they play in there.
Yeah.
Just fantastic. I mean, I don't know if you watch Rick Beato. You know, he has a huge show on YouTube where he analyzes what makes this song great. You got to check out his video on The Police. And he explains so exquisitely why they are so brilliant and why what they do is so unique and so utterly remarkable. And a lot of it comes down to Sting and his arrangements and his, and the other guys too, contributing too. But it's Sting is really the creative driving force of the songwriting and a lot of the musical arranging and the layering. Just tremendous, tremendous stuff. But anyway, what did you think of every little thing she does as magic?
Did you guys see him in concert?
You see him? Oh, God. It would have been great to see him.
It would have been tough.
Like I said, this video I have of their Synchronicity tour is just so awesome. It's breathtaking to watch Sting on the stage, and they play for like 2 hours.
How about some of you guys in Australia or in England? Right? You know, let us know. Did you guys see them? I mean, they love touring Australia.
Absolutely.
And of course,
they
England,
were number one in England and Australia on almost every album.
Italy? Laura, did you see them?
Yeah, Laura, let us know. Probably not, Laura. But anyway, hey, I hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to leave us a comment what you thought about it. It's a great selection for me, Nikki. I got a great great Police song for you too, off of Synchronicity, the Monster album. We're going to play the title song the two version of the title, because there's two songs called Synchronicity and Synchronicity 2, but we're playing Synchronicity 2.
By the way, before we get into that, I do want to mention that the Rolling Stone and VH1 listed them as their top 500 and 100 greatest groups of all time. Can you imagine? Five albums, folks. Five albums, and these guys are considered in the top 100 or 500, depending on which category you look in, of all time.
Totally unique rock performers with an unforgettable legacy.
Blows me away.
Unforgettable style. Anyway, I need to pause the CD because we're going to change it to play Synchronicity. We'll be right back. Okay, welcome back, everyone, and thank you for your patience during the intermission. We're ready to get into my selection of The Police off of their monster, huge, amazing fifth and final album, Synchronicity, released in 1983. The song I have selected, and I love all the songs on this album, King of Pain, Wrapped Around Your Finger, Every Breath You Take, so many gorgeous songs. But I really dig the energy and power of the next song, which is Synchronicity 2. It's got some tremendous lyrics, got some jumpy, memorable memory. And I like Synchronicity 2, but Synchronicity 2, Synchronicity also, Synchronicity 2 is my favorite of the two songs. So anyway, without further ado.
I've probably heard this maybe once or twice.
Nick might not know about it. So I'll be interested to see what he thinks about it. Hope you're going to enjoy it. So here it is from Synchronicity, the song, Synchronicity 2. Here we go.
Thank you.
That song really cranks, man. I really love the movement of that song.
I've never heard that song before.
Really?
Yeah. Oh. It was good. I liked it a lot.
Isn't it interesting the way the shifts are?
The shifts are amazing. I was like, I counted four different shifts, I think there was, right? From the melody to the chorus and then that interlude. And then there was another little part in there that was like completely different. But it all came together because of the music, the tempo. His singing really is good. The way that he can sing a kind of a low note to a high note really fast without changing to falsetto. Or if he does, I can't recognize it as falsetto. But really good.
Oh, it's an engaging, really driving song. And I mean, you're right. The melodies they write are so interesting. Okay, some are simpler than others. Some have more and more layery. But a song like this, you heard four or five little changes. And then the background stuff, like what gets introduced, a little guitar lick, or then, you know, and some other little bit of keyboard or some synthesizer in the background that, you know, it changes through the course of the song and it returns.
You guys are going to probably not agree with me. And I don't know why I'm even coming up with this, but without all the orchestration and stuff, it kind of reminds me of something like Moody Blue-ish in the way that they could construct songs and then kind of go off and somehow putting it all back together. I'd like to find out if who were the bands that he listened
that
to.
That he influenced them, yeah. You know? Well, the thing is, obviously, the Moody Blues sang more under control.
And then they had
Sting,
all this orchestration.
Sting is a lot more energetic, more passionate in his singing, you know, and he can tone it down for the beautiful love songs that they do and the heartbreaking ballads, you know, like King of Pain, where, you know, his voice can really just go where it needs to go. But when he's amped up, my God, you know, I mean, it just follows the music and it follows, if you see him live too, following his body as he performs, while he sings these songs, it all just comes together in this amazing orchestration.
And the drummer, I mean, I
Stewart
wonder
Copeland's
what happened.
Remarkable.
What happened to him?
I don't know if he went solo playing with some other guy. You know, a lot of, you know, Andy Summer and Stewart Copeland really didn't want the breakup, but Sting was ready to move on to a solo career, and you know, they really were hoping that that the Police would stay together, and they didn't have any animosity when they broke up. But I know that the other guys really loved the time they spent with Sting on the Police, and just great work. I also want to mention too, if you don't know, Sting was a star in a movie. I had a part in, I don't know if you ever saw the movie Quadrophenia, made in 1979. It was loosely based on the Who's album from 1973, Quadrophenia. He played a guy named Ahmad. You know, it's between the story of the mods versus the rockers in England there, the kind of two kind of stylish social musical young groups, not musical groups, but they were like fans of music. And so they were kind of like clubs, almost like the Jets and the Sharks in West Side Story, only it's not based on race, it's based
remake
on
remake. Right
music.
Now there's a movie out.
But anyway, he played a guy named Ace Face, who rode a motor scooter all the time. He's kind of a badass three times. So if you get a chance to see Quadrophenia, check it out. It's worth it just to see Sting performing. He's a pretty darn good actor.
He showed
as well
Dire
as a
Straits pate.
And his pates. But hey, hope you enjoyed Synchronicity 2. Hope you loved our choice from Ghost in the Machine, Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic. The Police, 5 albums, but an amazing legacy. Tremendous.
Amazing.
And you still got Sting's solo work, which is really wonderful too. If you love the voice of Sting and the style, you should check all that out. But hey, thank you for joining us today. Remember, if you enjoyed what we did, if you love our passion, love our enthusiasm, subscribe, like, share, and leave us a comment. And we'll look forward to seeing you next time on Nick and Knarf.
Take care, guys.
Take care. Bye-bye.